Olena, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, colleagues, I'm very happy to be here. I mean, I got the invitation early on, some time ago. I was immediately saying yes, and I kept my decision. Also, there are always many other things coming up. So I know this is an important issue at a relevant time. I've never been in Ukraine personally, so I mean virtually, we are everywhere, but personally, so I'm very happy to be here today. Now, I have been asked to give the keynote, which is a big honor, and I hope I can give some insights in a broad strand of literature. Basically, we combine research on migration and research on well-being, which are two very vibrant strands in economic research and beyond, and which are driven by urgent questions from real life, in particular countries who are in transition or in conflict. Now, this presentation here will not focus much on forced migration, because that's the topic of a panel which I have been asked to chair afterwards. So I focus on the issue in from a general perspective. But before I start, yes, I should thank the organizers, Olena in particular, but also Olga Kupitz, who helped me personally in very many ways to prepare this presentation and the event in general. Now, early on, already in my career, I have been related to Ukrainian issues. When I was the president of DIW Berlin, the largest German think tank in economics, and the director of ICA, by the way, for a decade in both positions at the same time, I was happy to support the initiative of Hartmut Lehmann and in particular him, but others, to create an Ukrainian longitudinal monitoring survey. This success story of this data set has helped me also early on to work on Ukrainian data myself. So you see here a few publications in the Economics of Transition Journal and the Eastern European Economics Journal on Russian-Ukrainian divides in political and earning sides at early on. I also was involved in advising the EU Commission in a larger project about migration from the Eastern Partnership migrants to Europe, and there's also a paper which has documented part of this research. So I'm happy, as I say, to be here at this occasion to be also confronted with the real challenges and all the chances you have in this country. Now, the table of content for my talk, very ambitious, are these points. I briefly would like to talk about the value of mobility. I would like to discuss the GDP versus happiness issue. I deal briefly with measurement issues. I'll share with you research questions which are on the table. Only some of them are solved, or well, I would say even touched. Many of these issues are not yet really touched in research, and hopefully some of you will have the chance to take on ideas and answer questions which are badly needed for our societies and the world. Then I will share with you tour de force through some publications which have also to do with my personal research activity, but not only. I cannot present the complete literature, which is already too large, but in three parts. How do migrants affect the natives is something what is of relevance in policy making very much, and it has been studied. we look at how the well-being of migrants in the host countries can be traced back to things which happen at home. Yes, so people still consider what goes on at home in the country of origins, and that's the next point, number 6. And 7, we briefly look into migrants abroad and the well-being of the left behind. What happens to those who migration who have not moved themselves? And if there's time, conclusions and challenges, I'm sure very, very, very short. Now, let us go on, the value of mobility. Now, there's a broad strand of literature, and as Olina has already said, there was not much evidence when I was chosen program director of the Center of Economic Policy Research 20 years or so ago, or more, 30 years ago. Now I reveal my age, okay? So then for a decade we had the idea to provide knowledge and evidence, and it's there now in Europe broadly, also, of course, as always for the United States. We know that migration in general has economically positive effects on the receiving countries in particular. Mobility in general, we teach this in the first classes of economics, improves the allocative efficiency of labor markets, and there are many possibilities that migration helps to adjust disequilibria in markets. We have brain circulation, which facilitates international trade, transfer of technologies and knowledge. It eliminates bottlenecks to economic development in many ways. This is all documented by lots of empirical studies around the world. By the way, migration is not about homogeneity, it's about variety. Yes, it's about diversity. If people would be all alike, economies would not benefit from anything, as we know from simple economic theory. There is no advantage from being alike. Being different is what makes it economically interesting and fruitful. Well, also free movements benefits the migrants themselves. That's clear because that's why they are moving. Not always, if they are forced migrants, that's very clear. And not all, let's say, illegal migrants who entering Europe, for instance, really are so benefiting when they see and what happens with them when they are arriving in Europe. The reality is sometimes a surprise. But free movements benefits the migrants themselves. They have jobs and earnings. They do not take welfare, by the way. The welfare take-up hypothesis is often refuted by scientists, but it's a very popular topic. People move to collect for welfare measures. It's a very popular theme in Europe, but it's a misguided, one of the many misguided issues. Remittances, return migration, diaspora networks help the countries of origin. Also, this is broadly, of course, there's always conflicting results. There might be studies here and there proving the opposite, but the broad evidence we have is consistent with the picture, not only in Europe, but also in the United States and in other parts of the world. Nevertheless, reality out there in societies, that's why events like this one are very important. Reality is that scientific facts are ignored. They are either not known or they are just ignored in policy debate. For instance, the Brexit was a big example of this. While we scientists have proven that migration EU enlargement was beneficial for the UK, lots of the rural area voters in the UK have voted for the Brexit because they thought that their misery would have been created by EU enlargement, among other things. So just as an example, how things are working wrongly. Also, inequality and foreign labor, okay, I don't want to talk about causality here, just a correlation at the first sight, but also there is, it's free from the wrong kind of relationship. More foreign labor in the country, the higher the share, the more equal the country is, yes, at least. So it's not that migrants would cause inequality, yes, the opposite. Is true, but also ignored. Now, we have studied a lot the impact of EU enlargement on the labor markets in Europe. There are two volumes shown here, which were produced under my guidance, together with Martin Kahanec from the CEU in Budapest. And there's also the International Handbook on the Economics of Migration, where lots of the evidence on migration and the frontier issues are discussed. Now, let me turn, yeah, and if you look, want to look a little bit on the mobility issue within Europe and how it's important, how important and how valued, much of value this is also, then you can look into this paper. Which summarizes the results. Basically, when we talk about mobility, we want to see across countries that if there are asymmetric shocks to the economies of the states, how migration can help to adjust faster. And actually, it's true that it happens. It happens not enough, but it's certainly contributing to the European welfare. Now, let me turn on from migration in general to GDP or happiness. People in the past were using the GDP as a measure of well-being also, yes, as a measure of success. And there has been a broad literature for many decades that this is, in many circumstances, very misleading. Recently, we have the rise in the interest to use happiness or well-being data to replace the GDP. There's an ongoing debate, as you may know, how whether this can be done and how far this is done. Of course, this is based or follows decades of discussions in many parts of sciences about sets of indicators measuring the situation of countries, and is also outside of the literature. Now, Stiglitz, Fitoussi, Sen have recently presented the report of a big committee, also initiated by Sarkozy, the French president at the time, to replace the idea after it was after the big crisis. Yes, the big crisis. We were thinking about whether, or many policymakers were thinking about, if the economy, the GDP is looking so bad, couldn't we find something else which looks better? And so they had the idea to bring out the happiness measures. That was part of the motivation. We have the report, and certainly it's an interesting report, challenging, but the discussion is ongoing. Some people say we need something like a cross-national happiness index, and some countries have already made the statistics for that. But others still write about why happiness is not enough to replace GDP. Well, okay, at the end, the question is, how can we measure this thing, and what can we do? Measurement of happiness and well-being. There are basically three groups of variables which have been produced to and used in academic studies to look into what drives our well-being or happiness or whatever it should matter. Happiness is a nice thing, and often the interesting stuff here is that even neoclassical economists, yes, can find this interesting, because utilitarian supporters, the maximization of utility can be related to happiness. Well, but some people even argue this is measurement of utility. I'm not want to go into this discussion here. It would be an own presentation. I'm just saying I'm interested in see how we can measure happiness. Now, the easiest thing is something you ask direct: are you happy or not? Yes. For instance, in the so-called World Value Survey, there is a question: taking all things together, would you say you are not at all happy, not very happy, quite happy, very happy? And you give numbers to these alternatives, and then you can calculate statistics. And well, if you take the data of this World Value Survey from 81 to 2004, then the average happiness gives the numbers which you seek. Top on this list in these years has been Colombia. Well, maybe because of cocaine or whatever. It's a wonderful country. I mean, I can understand. I have been in Medellin and in other countries, other cities a few times, but I can understand why people are so happy there. It's a very nice and beautiful country. It's on top of this list. Denmark is only below. The United States is below, but still in the middle field. Uganda is not so bad. Germany is not yet so good. Close to Bangladesh, yes. Germany is close to Bangladesh. Romania, Bulgaria, Ukraine, Albania are the lowest. Yes, Ukraine and Albania are the lowest on this ranking. That is interesting to see. So it has not necessarily something to do with the state of economic development. Yes, if Germany is next to Bangladesh, then there must be other things going on. That's part of also that this is not giving the absolute comparison that's of poverty. It has nothing to do directly with poverty. That's also what we have to realize when we look at these numbers and the pros and cons. Now, another way to look at the issue is life satisfaction, often asked in economic surveys, for instance, in the German socioeconomic panel, but in many others of the world. It's then called subjective well-being. How satisfied are you with your life as a whole, all things considered? And answers are reported on an 11-point scale, with 0 completely dissatisfied, up to 10 completely satisfied. And this is often considered to be a valid proxy for individual utility. There is a large literature using that measure, and it's well often correlated with other self-reported happiness and mental health measures, as has been documented. So all these measures, also they measure different things, yes, very clearly. They're also highly correlated, saying that there's a tendency of being somehow reliable. That's at least what the argumentation is. Yeah, well-being. Well-being has also to do with the negative side of well-being, with depression. Hope and despair are close. The depression is maybe an interesting picture reflecting what things can be. Now, not economists, but psychologists for decades are using what is called the GHQ thing, the so-called General Health Questionnaire 12 indicator. And if you look through these 12 questions quickly, I don't want to read them. There's also this idea directly being feeling reasonably happy, all things considered. This question is number 12. You have heard that before. It's one of the 12 issues. But also lost much sleep over worry and been able to enjoy your normal day-to-day activities and so on are questions. If we try to answer them for ourselves, we often will say, oh, not good. So most of us, by the way, have mental health problems, or had them or will have them in their life. So it's a general way which we have to cope with in life. And so it's psychologists found this battery of questions helpful. And there's tons of literature to prove that if you add up the thing and if you deal with these numbers, they give quite reasonable answers of your well-being. So these are the kind of alternatives. So this is how I myself was involved in collecting data for rural Bangladesh for a different type of project, but also there you see a distribution, how this looks if you add up the numbers related to these 12 questions. So, mental health, by the way, is a real issue in even advanced economies, or in particular, you could say, but also in less developed countries. Richard Layard has written a lot about it and has made clear that to a large extent, this affects the economy. For instance, according to his estimates, about 4 to 10% of the European Union GDP is lost by mental health issues. 40% of all sickness cases below age 65 in companies are rooted in psychological problems. So this is a big issue. The well-being in general, even this is not forced migration, yes? It's about a normal difficult life, so to speak. Now, research questions. If you have all this data and we look at now not well-being in general, but well-being and migration, there can be lots of issues you can ask yourself and maybe study. Now, my opinion is that happiness is and well-being, this is an interesting topic because this is an ultimate goal of life. Yes, we want to be happy, we want to do well and want to feel well. It's expected happiness that motivates efforts, and well-being makes these efforts possible. But happiness and life satisfaction can also support inactivity and cause stagnation. If you're happy, why would you leave the tree and to build up an economy or whatever? Unhappy people are ready for a change and mobility, and the expected higher happiness and greater well-being is the driving force. Hence, the more unhappy people should be the one who migrate, ceteris paribus. So unhappy countries like Ukraine, Romania, Bulgaria should have higher emigration rates. Yes, and you know better the reality whether this can be true or not. So this has some background. Whether migrants become happy through migration is highly unsure, by the way. Perhaps new arrivals are happier than before, but this may change soon after facing immigration challenges. Typically, migrants should be and are less happy than the natives in the host country. Probably migrants are and remain less happy than those individuals not migrating, staying at home in the country of origin. Families and friends left behind are probably less well or happy, even if they are compensated by remittances and other support, because they're not together with the family and friends abroad. Whether migrants become happy through, smiley, I'm sure I said this already, migrants may adapt happiness, well-being over time and across generations, potentially in the direction of the happiness, well-being of the natives. That's another issue to be studied. Typically, migrants in the second generation, are from the migrant group, the second generation are closer to the happiness of the native population. So there's some kind of adjustment as we see and should see probably. Migrants may still be dependent on what happens at home when they have left the country of origin. So the issue is this true? The situation at home affects the happiness and well-being of the migrants in the immigration country, and also what's happening with the situation in the host country. What are the interactions? That's one of the topics we will talk in a moment more deeper. Yeah, natives' well-being, happiness may be affected by the presence of migrants. Yes, you can be annoyed, but you can also profit a lot from the services migrants deliver. So what's happening with natives' happiness? A very important issue we will talk about in a moment. Well, unfortunately, fortunately, that's a challenge of research, well-being, happiness is not a stable concept. You see, if you adapt to your situation, you can what you found bad yesterday, you may find acceptable today, and so your happiness can change. And that's, in a rough sense, summarized as Easterlin paradox. So you see, the United States becomes richer and richer, but people don't become more happy and more happy. Yes, so you adjust to the level of happiness. Measures, and I indicated already, of happiness are not reliable indicators of the true objective well-being. Yes, poverty might be, Bangladesh and Germany have the same happiness measures. Yes, then you would agree that there is something missing. I'm not saying that's a relevant issue for the issue we would want to look at is missing, but that it's not, it has to be interpreted with care. These are no measures of poverty. Of course, all these policymakers can see these measures as object of manipulations, propaganda may affect people. Well, yes, maybe North Korea people are happy as in Germany, I don't know. So maybe that's part of the propaganda. To study the evolution of happiness in context of migration, one need unfortunately data we do not have. We have data before people migrate, other data after people migrate, and in different kinds of situations. So we don't have yet the panel data to really study the process completely, but I'm sure there will be a time coming where, in particular with the new internet data, where this might become more realistic, and there are already attempts to do so. So I will not be able to touch most of these issues. Large of those issues are completely under-researched, or there is no research at all. And though there is maybe something you may want to take up at some time. Also, this indicates that even so many people are optimistic that we can use happiness measures in the context of policy making. I agree with this to a certain extent, but we do not have, in many aspects, all the relevant evidence we need to really do a solid policy on a broad basis. So we have to do research, and that's an open invitation. Now, let me go a little bit into, very quickly into details. This is all based now on hard publications, yes? And I'll give you the sources, and you may wish to look into that if you are fascinated by this or the other issue. So one issue is migration and the well-being of the natives. Now, the point is, from the public debate, you may think, oh, it's obvious where migrants are, there is trouble, so natives must be unhappy about this or feel bad. Okay? That seems natural. But the evidence we have, broadly spoken, is the opposite. Yes? It's not that natives know why they are more happy, or yes, but it's a hard fact that in some countries where we have done research, like in Germany, it's clear that the Germans are more happier in areas where there are more migrants. Yes, and there is a causal impact there, and I don't go into the proof of causality here, but that's the outcome here. So contrary, at least in the broad evidence we have, migrants are supporting happiness of the natives. Well, simple explanation is that migrants provide services, push down costs of goods and services, and so on. This is why this will happen. Now, there is a set of literature, there's more, but this is the core of the literature Akai et al. Have published in the Journal of Economic Behavior and Organization and the Journal of Population Economics papers showing for Germany that this happens with migrants, the share of migrants at the one side, but also with ethnic diversity. Also diversity helps to improve the happiness of natives, yes? And that's what the two studies are. Kuroki, however, for the, also forthcoming in the Journal of Population Economics, as a footnote, I should warn you, I'm the editor-in-chief of the Journal of Population Economics, so I know these papers very well, because I was in charge of accepting them. Here, the Kuroki shows for the United States that whites are feeling more unhappy with the presence of ethnics. Yes, migrants and non-white people. That is conflicting. So we have this kind of things. Now, a more broad but more macro analysis was done by Bitz and Simpson. They studied for many OECD countries and showed that while international migration, the flow, inflow, has a positive impact on the well-being of native populations in Europe. Now, looking at, well, these are the journals, and also you find in the handbooks the article by Simpson summarizing migration and happiness. So, because this area is exploding at the moment a bit in research, so the handbook article from 2013 reflects the situation until that time, but afterwards we have seen a number of additional publications, including her own paper. Now, I could go now a little bit deeper. I don't have much time to give you the details of the evidence creation here. The original study by Akai et al. Used the German socioeconomic panel, and studied life satisfaction, that's a key variable here used, of the native Germans. And the outcome is, as I said, that there is improvement of happiness of measured or life satisfaction by natives through the presence of migrants. Now, the newer study, just fresh, 2017, of Akai et al. Now is looking at ethnic diversity. Yes, the diversity, they create a diversity index, and look again on the same measure of well-being of German natives and find a positive effects. And find also again that results are very robust to tons of alternative ways to look at the issue. The positive effect of ethnic diversity is stronger for immigrant groups that are culturally and economically closer to Germans, yes, or Germany. As I said already, Kuroki is forthcoming. It will be in the printed version in 2018. He matches individual data on the with the county level population data during the period 2005 to 2010 in the United States, and he looks at the racial diversity and immigrant population at the local level, which tends to be associated with lower life satisfaction for whites. So we have kind of a conflicting evidence on this topic in a different country. However, one has to admit that here that and the author also writes that the measured impact is relatively small, so the effect is modest. It's not comparable. It's not a big deal. Which I don't want to downplay that result, but we have to look at significance at one side and also the size. You see, empirical factors have to be judged on two levels. On is it statistically sound, I mean, is it significant? And is the effect big? So something can be very significant but very small in the effect. Yes, a small effect but very significant. And some people even say, what do I care about significance? The size of is the relevant one. I'm not want to go into that debate here. Now, Beetz and Simpson have looked at the European Social Survey. And have studied 26 countries between 2002 and 2010, and used again the life satisfaction variable as a measure of one measure, but also the happiness measure. So both measures are used here. They have a nonlinear effect, the more complex, but overall positive impact on the well-being of natives. So they support that from that side. So also here results are small in magnitude, the warning. So we have to get more evidence on these issues. This is just the beginning of a broader literature which is going on in the, yeah. Now I go to the second general topic, the well-being of migrants and conditions at home. So in a nutshell, what is this about? So migrants have moved from many parts of the world. Here in the data we are using in the moment to Germany. We're using again the German sociocritical panel here. And the issue is if something happens at home, which on the macro conditions, let's say unemployment went down or economic growth goes up. So the country of origin is doing well. There are two reactions migrants in Germany could have. One reaction could be, oh, wonderful, people at home doing better, I'm happy. They're happy. The other possibility is, well, I should have been stayed at home, yes. Why I'm here in Germany? It would better be in Bangladesh. Economic growth has risen, yes. Then the issue is, well, have I made a mistake? So you should feel less happy or less well, yes. Now, what do you think is the outcome? Most of you will probably think first that people should be happy. People at home doing well. No, it's the opposite. Migrants in the host country feel bad if things go well at home on a macro level. I'm not talking about the relatives and friends. I'm talking about the economy. So this is also causal. We have published a paper, I'm one of the courses here, macroeconomic conditions in home countries and the well-being of migrants, published in the Journal of Human Resources this year, also fresh research. So as I said, solidarity, altruism at the one side, or competitive feelings. That's what comes out. And not only that, well, if things are going well in the host country on the macro conditions, then you feel better, of course. So you feel better. As a migrant in Germany, if you have chosen the right country and the right region where you are, yes, then your happiness goes up or your well-being goes up. And if things go wrong at home, you also feel happy, yes. Or if things go good at home, you feel not happy. We use in this study German socioeconomic panel for 24 years and 24 countries of origin. There are tons of data. It's again, the well-being measure is subjective life expectations. As I said, strong evidence is found that migrants' well-being responds negatively to increase in the GDP of their home country. So, how has this, also what is important is the effect, however, yes, you feel as a migrant in the host country, in Germany, it vanishes over time. The longer you stay in the country, with duration of residence, or the stronger your assimilation with the host country, with Germany is, the less you care about what happens at home at all. So your reference group changes from the home country to the host country. So the effect declines with duration of residence and the degree of assimilation. Now, there's tons of empirical material, and I don't want to go through this here for the issue of time. But for instance, if you look at this kind of picture, you see the following. Let's say the Turks are the blues at the left, and the greens are the Italians, and so on. So then you see the connected points which represent a country of origin. So the colors respect different countries of origin. The more you go to the right, the higher the local real GDP per capita is. So of course, well, there's a shift to the right and also a little bit to above, to a higher level of well-being when the GDP per capita is increasing. But you see that within an ethnic group or a country of origin, you see a negative decline. So for the Turks, for the Italians, the Poles, the Greeks, the Spaniards, there is a negative correlation, so to speak, between well-being and GDP. So well-being goes down when the log of real GDP goes up within a certain group. So this indicates already what comes out, and the effort of the authors here, tons of material, confirms that. And I'm not going into the regression topic, but it's hardcore. Basically, we look into the gamma in this function, the macrovariables, what do they do to the subjective well-being indicator, and with complex things behind. And this is an issue of reference group behavior. I explained you already what is meant, and I come back to that in this second. This is very nicely, the output is very nicely described here. There are blue lines, they are dashed coming from below. The middle line of the three blue lines are the estimates when we interact the gamma, the macro variable, with the time in the country. And you see the longer, at the beginning it's negative. If something happens at home, you have a negative impact. This goes up to zero and even becomes positive at the end when time evolves. Now, the purple lines above have to do with the economic situation in the counties you're living in Germany as migrant. And you see the estimates do the opposite. They are positive at the beginning. That was the hypothesis. And at the end, it goes to zero. Now, this just confirms in a graph what I said, that there's reference group behavior. The well-being of migrants is negatively affected by positive macro developments at home, positively affected by positive situations in the receiving counties. But this vanishes over time. This has to do with integration and with the reorientation of people. If you look at integration variables, which are tested here, we again tested the interaction variable when we interact the coefficient with the integration measure, that when you wish to stay permanently, then the issue, the negative effect is smaller than you wish to stay temporarily. So just as an example. So this is broad evidence for this topic, and I don't have to summarize that again. Now, let me then come to the issue of what happens with those left behind. Yes, typically migrants are going alone, not the whole family, at least at the beginning, if it's labor migration. So if they're often wife or kids or parents or friends are left behind. There's a broad literature studying what this means for those at home. It's also very relevant in many countries, not only in Romania or Ukraine, but also in China, for instance, where millions of people move from the, or have moved from the rural areas to the cities, and where a lot of concern is what happens to the kids of families, migrant families, and their future, just as an example. So there's a lot of social concern. We focus here on direct effects of on well-being, and there are remittances and social remittances I would want to look at, where we have direct estimates on well-being. Now, with the remittances, I look at the research paper dealing with Chinese rural urban labor migration. And when it comes to social remittances, I briefly discuss a study using Romanian and Bulgarian data to look at the social behavior at home, which has to do with the well-being of the those left behind, the country left behind. Now, remittances is an enormous problem, or not problem, a possibility, chance in through migration. There's a huge cash flow moved around the world. For instance, in China in 2005, there was an estimate of nearly $30 billion of value from urban to rural areas. Okay, now, so somehow the, of course, if family is left behind, they of course lose family, the migrants, that could have a negative effect on well-being, but then we have replacement remittances. And what is isolated that effect? There are a few studies dealing with that, and I look in particular on a paper which has been published in the China Economic Review, which tests the idea in the Chinese context. Now, in China, there are two possibilities why these remittances have been undertaken. One has to do with altruism, the other has to do with contractual behavior, so kind of obligations, social obligations to help the parents or things like that. So there are some competing aspects of remittances and how they affect well-being. So then in the nutshell, yeah, of course, you're not surprised, perhaps, but remittances have a positive, even controlled for endogeneity issues, yes, have a positive impact on well-being. However, there are two aspects we find in the data. One is when family at home is poor, so to speak, then sometimes, well, there are remittances. Remittances are higher when family is poorer, the family is at home. So this is more an issue of altruism. But then there's also remittances which have to do with the higher income of the households are at home. And we interpret that as elements of fulfilling contractual obligations. So taking care of responsibilities. And this is tested again complex in the data. The data we're using is the 2008 wave of the migrant household survey, which is part of the rural urban migration in China, RUMIC data set, and a large number of publications have come out of that data set, and I was also involved in supporting the creation of that data set. And the data covers rural to urban migration, randomly sampled from 15 of the major urban destinations in China, and we have about 4,700 cases to look at. And here we use, or it's used, the General Health Questionnaire, GHQ data, so this other measure of well-being, which is also sometimes called mental health, yes? So if you look at the distribution between individuals receiving remittances and individuals who are not receiving remittances, you see that they have both these kind of structure, not completely alike at the lower, at the higher levels. I don't want to go too much into details, but to give you the clue of the paper in a nutshell, this slide, again repeating or stressing what I said already, indicate already, there's altruism and there are there's a presence of implicit contracts. And in a poor altruistic model, the main objective of the migrant is to support individuals left behind. The poorer the family back home, the higher the level of remittances should be. Yes, that's one finding. And under the alternative contractual hypothesis, remittances are the price in exchange for certain contractual services. If the price of these services increase with wealth, then it should mean the following. The richer the family back home, the higher the level of remittances. Obviously, two different things. We have complex ways to check for that. I have no time to go into details of this. But what we find is that both aspects have a basis for existence. So both motifs are there in different groups of migrants. The last but not least example covers a completely new strand of literature, which becomes more and more of interest for economists, because migrants are not only sending money or come back themselves at some time or something like that, or invest in the country of origin, but also they learn different things in like norms and change their preferences and so on. So the issue is to what extent are these global standards or standards relevant in certain countries? Democratic feelings, the role of females, I mean, lots of different things, the social engagement, and the issue of social engagement has been looked at in this study, coming out, or just came out now, published in the Journal of Comparative Economics, one of the sponsors of this conference. I'm happy that this was published in time. This is a joint paper with two people from Romania and Bulgaria, two colleagues, where we looked at what does it mean to have friends and relatives abroad to their own social activity at home. Now, social activity at home in Romania and Bulgaria was very low. So that is an interesting aspect. And what we basically find that social remittances have a positive effect on social activities at home. We use subsamples of the Gallup World Poll for 2006 to 2014. These are about 13,000 observations. And again, this is tested in various ways. And we find that this is the case, what I said. Also, what is also in this paper, which is also maybe a little bit shocking and interesting for this kind of conference, we are looking at, if you look at the low level of trust in societies across Europe, there's a very low level of trust in the Bulgarian and Romanian societies. This is based on the 2011 European Values Survey. So the question has been, generally speaking, would you say that most people can be trusted in your country, or that you can't be too careful in dealing with people? Now what you see there is across, if you compare Albania, Cyprus at the end with Denmark and Norway at above, it varies between 10% and 80%. This is a very shocking difference of social aspects. Now, what the mission of this paper basically is, who are those who are raising the hand, taking responsibilities and helping others, creating welfare. Okay, now I know that we have been a little bit started later, but I look at my time and I am a little bit late. I should end here my tour de force with the issue of migration and well-being. I hope I was able to show that there's some light in the jungle, because migration, if you look at it as a topic as an outsider, and well-being, if you look at this topic as an outsider, looks already complex if we look at those differently. If we look at them together, it's even more complex and more open. We have already lots of answers, at least beginning of stabilizing facts, but we know that research is about repeating and repeating, making clear that the evidence is hard and reliable and persistent. And second, also better understand what is behind. So I think that even looking at the tons of literature which has been created in recent 10, 20 years, and on both fields, yes, I would argue there is lots of space and lots of needs for additional research. And I hope that some of you will have the chance to contribute successfully to this area. Thank you very much for your attention.